أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا Seeking ibad Allah wa nafsi bi taqwallah. In today's khutbah, in the first one, I would like to again talk about the current situation, especially on the North American scene, where we see that, you know, the students in the universities and even the high schools are becoming more active and aware of the situation as far as the Palestinians are concerned. See, America goes around the world preaching about human rights and democratic values, but the conflict in Gaza Strip basically has exposed the hypocrisy in a way that we didn't see before. And it's not surprising that you will see the universities have become an arena of dissent against the U.S. government and policies. Four university presidents were questioned about their policies regarding anti-Semitism on their campuses. When it came to the pro-Palestinian protests by the students, although it started there in the early days of the present conflict, but the protests have now escalated to encampments that we see where the students are actually asking their universities to divest from genocide and to start, stop investing the large school endowments that they have in the companies which are in manufacturing weapons, which are then supported, supporting the Israel's war in Gaza. Many of these encampments started, major of them started in Columbia University in New York, and now has spread around the U.S. from the Northeast coast to Texas and California, and students have been arrested at different, universities. High schoolers in Seattle actually walked out of the classes in protest of the war. And today, the school officials in New Jersey have warned the high school students against participating in a walkout planned for today. So we see the awareness is there, especially in the younger generations, but it has an impact even on the senior politicians. You know, it was very interesting to see the video released by one of the senior politicians from the Democratic Party. This is where we it shows that deep in their heart they know what is haq. But it is all other political issues, economic, interest, which are actually preventing them from speaking the truth. And here I'm referring to Senator Bernie Sanders, who was also a presidential candidate for the Democratic Party in the last election. And the way he responds to Netanyahu's claim that any criticism of the Israeli government's policies is anti-Semitic. This is a label used for any kind of, dissent or disagreement with what Israel is doing. And the way Senator Bernie Sanders have come out in his video, very powerful. where he begins by saying, "No, Mr. Netanyahu, it is not anti-Semitic or pro-Hamas to point out that in a letter, in a little over 6 months, your extremist government has killed 34,000 Palestinians and wounded more than 77,000, 70% of whom are women and children." These are his words. And so, you know, they cannot play around that these are the numbers from the Palestinians. And then he goes, using the same, tone and style, that no, this is not anti-Semitic. When we talk about these issues, he talks about destruction of 221,000 housing units, which has basically made a million people homeless, which is half of the Palestinian population in Gaza Strip. He talks about the civilian infrastructure, which has been completely destroyed, healthcare system, where all, you know, basically they have knocked out 26 hospitals and killed more than 400 healthcare workers. He also talks about destroying all universities which were there in Gaza Strip, 12 of them, and 56 school buildings. And of course, you know, talking about blocking the humanitarian aid and creating an environment where malnutrition and famine is becoming more and more, increasing now. And he ends with the words where he says, "Do not insult the intelligence of the American people." You know, it reminds me of the conversation of Prophet Lut with his people, where he ends by saying, "Isn't there anyone, Rashid, and wise among you to understand what I'm saying?" You know, and this is where he's saying, "Don't insult the intelligence of the American people." I hope he sends this video with, you know, a special courier to President Biden, because he is the one who actually who needs to open his eyes. In the same bill that they got passed this week, you know, on one hand he's asking for money to feed the Palestinians and those who are in Sudan and other places. And at the same time, he's asking for $9 billion to send offensive military aid to Israel. So on one hand, he's feeding the Palestinians. On the other hand, he's giving weapons to Israel to kill them. And this is where we realize, you know, this is where we will say, "Isn't there anyone Rashid among them?" May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open their minds and hearts to the reality and come away from this path of zulm and injustice to people in any part of the world, inshallah. In Ahsan al-Hadith, Kitabullah al-Aziz, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wal-Asr, inna al-insana lafi khusr illa al-lazina amanu wa amila salihat wa tawasaw bil-haq wa tawasaw bil-sabr. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العتوف للعباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم بعد الله بالتوبة أما سلف من ذنوبكم. Just one more point before I move on to another theme for the second khutbah. You know, this level of anti-Semitic, you know, it has been used so many times that the glue has worn off. It's no more sticking. They use it for everything. any kind of dissent of the policy against the state of Israel, any kind of protest or remark, immediately they say, oh, this is anti-Semitic. And people realize that, you know, this cannot, this label cannot be used all the time in all the cases. The month of Shawwal is also the month where we'll be observing the death anniversary of our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, alayhi salatu wasalam. Of course, there's a dispute about the date of the wafat, whether it's 15th or 25th. It doesn't matter, as long as you commemorate that, you are fine. There's no need to fight on that because these are issues which cannot be resolved that easily. I would like to actually narrate to you a very interesting conversation from the sixth Imam as a lesson for many people, including ourselves. More akhlaqi, you know, moral issue, that once Imam went to visit Mansur. Mansur is one of the early Khalifa of Banu Abbas, and he was known for his tyranny, you know, very much against the descendants of Imam Ali. You know, he would not tolerate Ali at all, especially those who are from the descendants of Imam Hassan, because those were the ones who supported Banu Abbas in the rebellion or the revolution against Banu Umayyah. It is in that context that you hear the ahadith where people used to go to the sixth Imam those days and say, should we be part of this? An Imam would say, no, stay home. It was not for all situation and all the times. You know, it's not automatically that even if you're in Toronto 2024, it applies here. If you look at the context of the hadith where Imam is saying, don't get involved. Because Imam knew that the motivations of Banu Abbas was actually just to exploit this lineage of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And they found that opportunity through the descendants of Imam Hassan. Unfortunately, who didn't listen to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam on this issue. They were cousins, very close, but you know, they had their own interests there. And after the downfall of Banu Umayyah, it is Abbasid who took the power. Although the slogan was that we are fighting for the descendants of Ali Rasul. Wouldn't apply to them. They are Hashimi and even Ali are Hashimi. But Banu Abbas are not Ali Rasul. And because they considered Ali Hassan to be now a big threat, you know, Mansur started this campaign of eliminating them. So he had this buzz towards Ali in general. And that's why you will see that, you know, the descendants of Imam Hassan those days, they ran away from the central areas of the Muslim empire of that time. You have this shrine in Karachi. Is a Hassani Sayyid. Then you have this Sadat in North Africa, even the king of Morocco, even now, the descendants of Imam Hassan. The reason why these descendants of Imam Hassan, you know, travel that far away from the central, you know, lands of the Muslim empire at that time was to run away from the Zulm of Mansur. So keep that in mind, and Imam did not willingly go to see Mansur. this is under pressure, and he actually sent him a letter actually saying that, you don't come to visit me. And Imam said, well, what you have to offer, I don't need. What I have to offer, you will not listen to it. So what is the point of, you know, visiting you? Then he sent another kind of more humble and polite request. He said, at least come and counsel me. And this is where Imam, in one of those meetings, he goes there. And while he was sitting, according to the narration, waqa'a dhubab 'ala al-Mansur. You know, the fly, you know, Makki, what do you call, Maki in Urdu, in Gujarati, yeah, was coming and sitting on him. You know, those days, they didn't have these modern gadgets to keep your, you know, room clear. So the fly would come and sit on him. He will be very irritated. He will try to push it away. And it will go away and then again come and sit on him. And this is where Imam now comes in. So he sat down and again the fly came on him. And he became so irritated, he says, Ya Aba Abdullah, to the sixth Imam, Lima khuliqa al-dhubab, why was this fly created? It's a very simple question, huh? But look at the way Imam responds to him. لِيُضِلُّ بِهِ الْجَبَابِرَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this fly to humiliate the tyrants. You are the emperor now. You are the king of the Muslim empire. You have army. You have everything. But this one fly, you can't do anything. It's bothering you, irritating you, humiliating you in that way. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can even use, you know, a simple creature like a fly to humiliate the tyrants. You know, he doesn't need really very advanced means. Remember the story of Ababil? You know, so those arrogant, you know, leaders who are there, they had to keep in mind, you know, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides, it doesn't have to be from very advanced, what you call, you know, means of humiliation. He can even use a fly. You know, look at what happened to the virus that we had. The whole system stopped. You know, we couldn't do anything. Traveling, gathering, even our salat, Juma prayers stopped. And this is where this is a virus that we could not even see, other than those who are experts in the field. And this is where, you know, Imam uses this term when he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can even humiliate the jababira, the tyrants, through such a small creature. Salawat pranik parah. So we see the example of Mansur. You know, his arrogance is being challenged there by a fly. You know, rulers of the time. You can look at Marcos of Philippines, Shah of Iran, Saddam. These were all people who were very, you know, you look at all other Mubarak. The humiliation they went, they had everything. They had money, power, army, you know, but when the time comes, things change. But this is not only a problem of the jababira, this issue of arrogance. You know, I think we have to even relate it to all different levels of society. Not only the political level, business level, community, also societal level, even in family, you know, relationships. Arrogance is a human problem. Doesn't know any race or class or religion. And this is something, you know, when we talk about kibr, this is where we have to, you know, always remember this. You know, the emphasis that we have in Islam about congregational prayers, Salatul Jama'at. Yes, last night, one of the young individual was asking that, you know, there is a hadith which says that if you are a neighbor of the masjid, your salat is not valid until you go to the masjid. And he was worried. What happens to all me, the salat I had done? I was in the Middle East somewhere, but I didn't used to go to the masjid. I said, don't worry, your namaz is okay. What you've done. This is more akhlaqi hadith. You can't derive a fatwa from it. This is an emphasis that to go to masjid for the jamaat prayers. And one of the important benefits of that, besides many other things, is that if anyone who has this illness, spiritual disease of arrogance and pride, takabbur and ghurur as we call it, one of the spiritual cures for that is to regularly participate in Jamaat prayers. There's no reserve spot for anyone. For Imam Jamaat, yes, but doesn't have a name. Whoever would be the Imam Jamaat, he'll be there in the front. Otherwise, there is no seat. Even if, suppose, you know, somebody paid 100% for building this masjid, this doesn't belong to him. Once you've done the niyat of masjid, masjid is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cannot even say to the Jamaat that I'm donating the whole, you know, expense for the masjid, but I want one musalla to be reserved for me. It can't happen, Sharan. When you come and sit there in one spot, temporarily that's yours. Nobody can ask you to move. Even if you sit there regularly, one day you were late, you said, you please move, this is my spot. Khuda hafiz. This is not your spot. And if you forcefully, you know, basically ask that person to move from there, this is considered a sin by itself. And maybe some of the fuqaha will even say that your salat becomes batil. I'm not 100% sure about it. That's why this disclaimer is there. But it is definitely a sin. And this is where we come to realize that when you come to the masjid, you can't even say that, well, you know, I am for a high, upper class or this and that. You know, this person in front of me is a lower class person. No. You know, at the time of sajda, your head would be there and his feet would be in front of you. And that is the practical lesson of humility. Even this tradition that we have of emphasis in using turba, it is its own barakat. We know this is a tradition which has been emphasized by our imams after the events of Karbala, especially. That now that we had to put our forehead on the turab, on the earth, you know, it's, the preference goes for the earth which is taken from the grave of a shaheed. Because it has all its own, you know, spiritual benefits. We are told in one of the hadiths that when you do sajda on the turbat of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, your salat ascends, you know, covers through the veils until it reaches to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so that is there, but even on a social level, this is a reminder. The most important part of our body is our face. That's how we are known. Our ID is based on mostly the face. And there, the most important part is the forehead. By placing that on the turba, you are being reminded that this is your origin. You are from the earth. You are children of Adam, and Adam was created from turab. And that is, you know, that's why you will see sometimes there is also a recommendation that if you can have a smaller turba, a little bit, the lower position than the one you're putting on the forehead so that you can put your nose on it. I haven't seen a hadith. Don't quote me on this as a hadith. But when I think about it, probably this is, you know, the expression of what we say, you know, skin naak ragad di amne. You know, I basically rubbed his nose on the ground as a sense of humiliation. But that is from a zalim doing to you. This is you doing yourself. You know, reminding yourself that, you know, this whole issue of arrogance and pride has no place as far as the akhlaq and the behavior of a mu'min is concerned. And this is everywhere, even in our family, you know, relationships. Always remember that the first sin, as far as the history of humanity is concerned, is related to kibr and arrogance. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked the assembly of malaika, where even Iblis was part of that, to do sajda, all of them did sajda except him. And the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about it, he says, you know, he basically abba was takbara. He disobeyed, refused to do sajda. Was takbara, and he showed arrogance. So the first sin in human history would be actually, you know, although he was not a human being, but in the context of human creation, is kibr and arrogance and pride. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, keep us from this bala of a spiritual kind, inshallah. Allahumma salli ala sayyid al-mursaleen wa shafi al-mudhribin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن حسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما حيا صار البدو وتغيان هادم يا أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وسهل مخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.